your man. Well, I beg your pardon. Walk the straight and narrow track. If you walk with Jesus, he's gonna save your soul. You gotta keep the devil way down in the hole. He's got the fire and the fury.
Sorry, it's so good. I couldn't help but let it go on a little longer. I hope this is all turned up and whatnot. Hello. Happy Columbus Day. Although he is definitely one of those people that it would be and is a deep struggle to have love for. He is the enemy. serial killer, bad guy. But I pray for his soul in retrospect. Today, leaping into Ezekiel 33:17. Yet the children of your people say, this is again the word of the Lord came to Ezekiel and he said this stuff. Anyway, yet the children of your people say, the way of the Lord is not fair, but it is their way which is not fair. Ooh. When the righteous turns from his righteousness and commits iniquity, he shall die because of it. But when the wicked turns from his wickedness and does what is lawful and right, he shall live because of it. Yet you say, the way of the Lord is not fair. O house of Israel, I will judge every one of you according to his own ways. Now, in no way do I feel like this is a dismissing overall law and the ways in which God has told us to live. But in a way, he is saying, that he is looking at the hearts of men. Indeed, this is kind of the same thing, the words. It's about the heart and what comes out of it. And that indeed your actions and your words come out of your heart, whether you like it or not. And he is leading us in hope and prayer and faith to realizing and living in that. Of living out of the abundance of your heart and the abundance of your heart being him. Now, something I really love about this, because at first it just sounds dag mean, doesn't it? If you're righteous and you mess up, you're dead. But if you're bad and you start doing good, hooray! Now, I don't think he's saying the life of the righteous is not to be hooray'd. But he's saying righteousness is always a hooray, and iniquity is always a boo. Yea, righteous, boo iniquity. And I think we can look at that in two ways. My brain certainly goes one of two ways. One is the, like, whoa, Grimsley. And the other one is, it suits my extremist personality quite well. And also calls to mind the beauty of death and life in every action we choose. Then indeed to follow our own dust-centered views, our own temporal satisfactions, is literally every time you do it, you're choosing death, because all of this physical realm will pass away. And every time you choose something rooted in love and service and praise of that which is eternal, the spiritual realm, you were choosing life. And again, this is kind of part of my whole trying to, my mind becoming, being awakened, God shaking my mind loose of like the militaristic aspect of his law, but indeed see his law as beautiful. The law is perfect, transforming the soul, that it's transforming me from my natural inclination towards death and towards temporal pleasures, towards life, in every moment, in everything that he guides you to, and everything that he leads you away from. Is not to say, oh, you can't do that, that's fun, but I just don't want you to do that. No, that these things I'm calling you away from are death, and I myself am life. And God, as we know, is semi-obsessed with us avoiding death. And not in the way that we think about it, these temporal bodies, the pain and fright of heading into death in that way. is not a thing to be feared. And this life is not a thing to be feared. Suffering is not to be feared. Fear isn't to be feared. But indeed to draw unto life in every moment, simply through, sometimes through obedience, sometimes monumental sacrifice, and from our hearts on out, and that we can literally do things, serve others, and have it resonate throughout eternity. And that's the life he's talking about. So maybe I'm not focusing enough on the death side, and maybe I'll focus more on that tomorrow, but that's what made me rejoice about that today. Amen. Selah. Rejoice.